This is your traveling song, and I hope it sees you well through train rides and hotels. This is your traveling song.
I'm excited to be in the north after spending several weeks in southern and central Sweden. The drive up was so beautiful. I loved the hills, the sea, the tall pine trees. I'm happy to be here and energized and ready to get cracking.
We got a lot of
oxygen masks.
Okay. What, is that like medical supplies?
I see a hockey jersey. Yeah. I want to wear that.
Let's see what this coffer's about.
You know, I'm going into this week with an open mind. You never know on this show because it is the Great Swedish Adventure. So, ready for a challenge.
Here we go.
Dear Americans, welcome to the city of Umeå. Even though people have lived here since around 3000 BC, the city celebrates its 400th anniversary as an official city in 2022.
Oh!
So, happy birthday, Umeå!
Happy birthday!
That's just incomprehensible to me. There's no city, no county in America that's going to be celebrating their 400th anything.
Brittany, your family has lived in this area for many centuries. Since it pretty much was wilderness, basically pioneers up here, the family treasure chest belongs to you this week.
How?
Yay!
I'm so excited. Thank you.
This is just a miracle. I have been dreaming about this for years, and I'm sure that this story is deeper than anybody in my family knows, and it's something that my dad would be so proud to hear, and I wish he was gonna be home so I could tell him about it, but I have lots of beautiful people to share that with, so I'm really looking forward to this opportunity.
In Sweden, healthcare is free. Umeå got a great hospital, and now they will get some fabulous root-seeking Americans. Trevor, Erica, Sharon, John will be at the ER.
Wow!
Oh my gosh.
Right.
And Nikki, Sally, and Brett at the maternity ward.
Oh, yes. Oh, yay!
Wow. Okay, so now we have an incoming patient.
Okay.
So,
picked a good day to come in.
Yeah.
Tira.
Oh, she's beautiful.
Hey, Tira.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I just am counting down the minutes until I can run into that maternity ward and scoop up a little one and hold them tight. It's going to be an incredible day.
The coffer contains hospital stuff, birchwood, Umeå is the city of birches. Björklöven, scarf, for the people of Umeå, Björklöven is like Buddha for the Buddhist. Music of the region, this is one of the most productive regions in Sweden when it comes to great music. Gear up and do some good work, Anders. See what's in here, guys. Music.
Yeah.
A chimerical abomination in 12 bursts. Sounds dangerous.
Oh!
That is collector gear right there.
Oh my god, I'm scared.
Yeah, crank it, crank it.
Get out, scream!
That's what you said. Yeah!
I am so excited about being an intern at the hospital. I worked briefly at an emergency room when I was early married, and my sister is a healthcare practitioner.
Hey. Hello.
Hey. Welcome to the ER.
Thank you.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
Good. I'm not quite dressed for the occasion.
I'm really excited about being in the healthcare area today. I think it's very fascinating, interesting. I'm not a squeamish person, so I'm just excited for today.
Oh yeah, these are looking cool.
Because that's what you want when you're saving lives, to make sure you look your best, because you never know, you could get a girl's number.
I like these ones better, but it depends on how much muscles you want to show.
Oh,
you have a smaller shirt?
Yeah.
It's really interesting for me to be here because I started out my university as pre-med, and I thought originally I would be a doctor. And so it's pretty fun to be in scrubs, exploring a hospital, living the life for a day. I heard I get to do some open heart surgery today.
Yeah, that's what we do in the ER.
I'm ready.
Yeah. Good.
Been practicing.
Are these like obnoxiously big?
No.
Okay.
I mean, the thing with scrubs is that you get no body.
It's just a blob. Scrubs are comfortable. I'm kind of hoping they let me get to keep the pants. You can move in them. There's pockets everywhere. So I'm here for the scrubs.
Hello, welcome to the labor room in Umeå. I'm Maria. I'm a midwife and I work here.
Wow, I'm Nikki. Hi, nice to meet you.
Hello.
I love babies. I want a baby. You know, it's one of the things that I'm really ready to start in the next phase of life in terms of starting a family. So I'm just so happy to be lending a helping hand and excited to learn more about how the system works.
So here we have some blue scrubs.
I've never worn scrubs before.
I once had a pair of
I've dated scrubs.
So here we have the delivery rooms.
So in the US, when you're in giving birth, you can only eat ice chips. So do you guys have a lot of ice chips? Do you guys eat ice chips? Like, only let them eat ice chips?
No, we have regular food.
We have sandwich. Women in labor eat?
Yeah, they need to eat to have energy to give birth.
Yeah, they do. Okay,
they
sorry,
say
I'm just
giving
like
birth
out.
Is like running a marathon.
Starving me for nutrition. And you get so tired and they don't let you eat. You get so hungry and other people can eat around you, but they let their women eat while they're in labor. And so that was like the craziest thing for me, and I loved that. And what are those yarn balls?
Those are fake breasts.
Oh.
That's when we want to show how to breastfeed, and they don't really get it.
Oh.
So that's why we have them.
You know, it surprised me to see a knitted boob in a hospital. I thought maybe it would be a baby toy, and then to just see a basket overflowing with nipples, you know, took me by surprise.
Okay, so who wants to go first?
I'll go first.
That's brave of you.
So are you the one?
Ellen is the one.
You're the one. What's your name?
The COVID test was fine. It's kind of uncomfortable. It burns a little bit, but I had had one. I'd had some before, and so getting another one was no big deal. John was really a massive baby about it the whole time, but you know.
But you can smile through it.
Do you ever do two? Just like.
But double. It would be fun. I can do it on you.
I'll do two. let's go. Go big or go home.
Go big or go home.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm somebody that will try anything, you know, and I'm happy to do it. But also, yeah, I'm also not someone who just seeks out trying to stick things up my nose or in my ears or... So no, I was not super excited to do it.
Do you want me to explain how it goes?
No, it's okay.
I just really enjoyed John trying to get it because, yeah, sometimes, you know, just because you're a big guy doesn't mean you're brave.
Oh, don't hurt me.
Stop! You
I'm
said two.
I'm sorry.
Don't leave the house.
Here we have the room for fika.
Now I really feel like I'm on Grey's Anatomy.
We should make up water cooler talk.
Yeah.
So how about that C-section?
Yeah.
Lot of blood.
The biggest difference I see between Swedish and American healthcare is, of course, the cost. My friends who are moms spend thousands of dollars to have their baby in hospital.
But we pay taxes, and it's the cost of 100 Swedish crowns every day.
Yeah, because there's kind of...
giving birth.
When I had my first kid, I thought I had really good insurance, and I paid $250. But if I did it in Sweden, it'd be $10 for the night? Like, no, that's a cheap baby.
So, I mean, it's really interesting to like see this because healthcare is a big issue in the US.
Like everything is based on insurance. Like, my dad was, you know, dying of cancer and he had to go in to get treated. And he walked into the clinic that day and we had to pay like $8,000 to take him up the hill in an ambulance. And if they didn't do that, if my mom just drove him up the hill, then the insurance would not cover anything else. And so they had to do that in order to get the insurance coverage. It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
It's so messed up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's mind-blowing the price differences. So if you don't have insurance in the US, you're screwed. It can literally bankrupt a family. So it's really interesting to see here, like, people just don't have that fear, they don't have that worry, and it's taken care of.
Okay, so now we have an incoming patient.
Okay.
Okay.
How can we help?
Do we need masks?
We will put our masks on.
Yeah, I'm ready to do as much work as they'll let me do. This is super fun to just, you know, be involved.
Huvud
först. Picked a good day to come in.
Yeah. Yeah, I was able to help Sven with his oxygen mask. He had done it a number of times before, so he kind of grabbed it from me, and I just kind of put it on. But yeah, it was just to be able to even help to the slightest degree that I did felt good.
Känns det okej?
Ja.
Ja, då kör vi.
Ja.
Ja. Då tar jag munskyddet. Och så kommer Trevor sätta på den på över näsan.
Ja.
Ja.
Okej.
I have a little bit of medical experience. I was a combat lifesaver for my unit, so I think it's a really exciting time, especially because it's so different than America's.
How are you?
Hello.
All right. It'll be really fast, and I'll be nice and gentle, okay?
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
Blood, blood in there. Oh, wow. Det här har du gjort förut, säg.
All right. Oh. Ready? And just push down.
Push. Quite hard. Oh, good.
Oh.
So, and what?
This has been my favorite day we've had here so far. It's just incredible what they allowed us to do, incredible to see it happening. And I like a challenge, and you just, in the medical field, you never know what you're gonna get. It was an awesome day, Hannah was phenomenal.
We have neonatal care just next door, and they are very specialized neonatal care, and they take babies from week 22. So we have really specialized doctors and nurses working there. So when we have a baby that's not feeling well, we have a button here. And if we push that, they are here in like 30 seconds and help and helping us taking care of the babies.
So today I knew that we were going to have to go to a Bia Bia, and it's extremely difficult for me, as when we went in for the first time for our child to be born, we ended up losing our son.
The doctor was quite angry because my wife was taking so long to be in labor, right? Yeah. We were in there for 24 hours or so, and the doctor was going into politics, yeah. So he was out to shake hands and politic. And that's when the charge nurse looked up on that screen right there and could see the heart rate dip down into, you know, a very dangerous spot. Mm-hmm. And they came in, and it was just like out of a movie. All of a sudden, the room was swarmed with people. Mm-hmm. And they wheeled her down the hallway, and I went charging after my wife, and then they stopped me at the door, wouldn't let me in. Mm-hmm. And then our son was stillborn, but they were able to revive him because he was so big. Mm-hmm. But the damage was to the point where he was at a brainstem level of brain activity. Mm-hmm. And he died in the intensive care unit 2 days later.
Okay.
And like what you just said, you know, putting the baby on the skin is something that still haunts me because my wife never got to do that.
I keep those feelings really pushed down in my life. And today they all percolated up to the top.
Thank you for sharing that, Brett. Mm-hmm. I feel like in the States, you know, we hide stillbirths, infant loss, miscarriages. It's such a taboo subject in our culture. So, you know, I really appreciate hearing your story.
Thank you.
I never thought I'd get a tattoo, right? I was in the Marine Corps, and I, you know, most Marines got a ton of tattoos, but I had one tattoo, and it was for our son, Zachary Brett Goss.
There are some losses that stay with you your entire life, and so I feel really moved by Brett's story, and so the fact that he's been so open about what he went through, even though it really brings up a lot of pain for him, you know, he is a hero in my book. I wouldn't have had the courage to even walk into that ward, and he did that today, and my heart is with him right now.
And I don't want to end on a sour note. We have two gorgeous daughters that are now 21 and 19, so.
You know, I wonder what would Brett Goss have been like, and what would Tina Goss have been like if we didn't lose our son, Zachary. And I stop thinking about that because I think, well, maybe we wouldn't have had Molly or Lily, right? And I couldn't have been more blessed as a father to have, I mean, beautiful daughters that are smart and confident and secure, right?
Hey.
Hey.
Kan du bara komma och säga hej lite grann?
Grattis.
Tackar.
beautiful baby.
Oh, do you have a name picked out yet?
Tira.
Tira? Oh. Oh, she's beautiful.
Hey, Tira.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I forgot about the sounds they make when they're that young, those little cuddles.
It's my first daughter, so.
Congratulations.
Two sons. I've seen them
before. I have two daughters, so that's a wonderful, wonderful for a dad to have a beautiful little girl.
And the picture of that dad holding that beautiful little girl, his first daughter, that's a precious moment that can't be replaced. I'm an extremely lucky person today. The only thing I look forward to is when our daughters have children of their own and then I become a grandfather.
I was 8 years old and running with a dime in my hand to the bus stop to pick up.
As a child, I had a complete different childhood than my children had. And you know, I always think that I was kind of an inconvenience to my father in a way. I never remember playing catch with my father or any of the type of things that like a father and a son would do. I didn't want to repeat the mistakes of the past. I tried to break that cycle. No one's a perfect parent, but I made sure that our daughters were never beat. I made sure that they weren't belittled. I always wanted to be encouraging to our daughters, right? That, look what you can do. This is your
hometown. You know, I think the best place is gonna be to go is when I have my special day and see exactly where we're from. Being able to build a bridge, taking our daughters over there, showing them where we came from. You know, this is a trip for all of us. So I'll pioneer the way out there, and you guys can follow along.
Well, you'll be missed, honey, but I know that you're gonna be enjoying the time of your life.
Yeah.
Well, it's the only reason why I'm not sad is because I know you're gonna be on this amazing adventure, and I know you're super excited about it, and I'm excited for you.
People say I look like my grandfather.
My grandfather, Irvin Akerson, was a mailman, a father of four, a fantastic husband. And he was a huge influence because he was actually a big part of my life. So obviously that part of the environment helped flick some types of switches in me. And that's from the Swedish side, 100%. And out of respect, I want to explore that side of my past because my grandfather would respect the fact that I'm doing what I'm doing.
Love is defined by decisions.
This is a tribute to the Akerson side of the family, to my mother. So I'm really feeling their presence in my heart right now.
Dear Brett, your story starts with happiness. Lars and Margarita Jonsson welcome their second but first surviving child in the summer, 1823. Her name is Anna Kajsa.
Her older brother was named John. He lived for only 2 months.
The family welcomes a third child when Anna Kajsa is one. They name him Lars, after his father.
I read this and we had a son named Zachary, and he only lived 2 days. So I know how Lars and Margarita felt. And I don't say that lightly because people will say, oh, I know how you feel, but no, you don't. No, you don't, not unless you've been through it.
In 1844, the big family moves to Lilja Klubertorp.
Look around you and soak in your surroundings, because that's where you are today. This is absolutely a gorgeous, stunning area. All the trees and the wheat fields. This is amazing to think that this was a farm that they had. At least they lived in a beautiful part of the world, that's for sure.
From here, your story continues through their oldest son, Lars Larsson, born 1824. As oldest son, Lars would inherit the farm. Lars marries Johanna Eriksdotter in early April 1854. She's a soldier's daughter and 1 year his junior. They'd been married 2 years when Lars was charged with larceny. Three sacks of coffee and sugar had been stolen from Jan Peter Skoglund of Hallandsås and found at Lars' home. Lars is grilled in court, but ultimately acquitted. The evidence was all circumstantial. Besides, several witnesses testified. Everyone knows Lars and Johanna keep a key to their house just outside their door. So anyone could have done it, went the refrain.
I like that story. They didn't catch you red-handed, they don't even got to prove it.
Later that year, Lars and Johanna's first son is born on November 29th, 1854, a son named Franz August. 3 years later, they have a daughter, Maria Charlotta, but the tables were soon to turn again.
It's unclear why, but Lars sells the family farm he had inherited.
Was he overcome with the totality of farm life? Was an encroaching debt creeping up on him? Or was there a criminal flame underneath all those smoky rumors of criminality? Whatever the case, the family ends up living as tenants, renting a humble cottage on the farm that had once been their own domain.
That, you have to be pretty daggum humble to have been the owner of a house, sell it, blow the money, and then have to come back and pay rent where you own the place. I don't know if I'd do that. I think I'd move somewhere else. I don't know, maybe my ego would be too big to do that. Obviously, there was no ego. It was just the best decision at the best time for his family.
Two more children are born into these simple conditions. Johanna Christina, born 1860, and Emma Matilda, born 1865. With pressure mounting all around him, Lars hits a new low on a February night in 1868. He's caught red-handed with stolen sacks of oats headed for Mariestad. He's hit with fines and has no chance of paying, meaning hard time in Mariestad's prison.
And that's a place that I've been myself, unfortunately. On our day off, we spent the night in that prison. Wow, I've been in the same joint.
Wow, 4 years for stealing oatmeal. Just to survive. You know, an army marches on its stomach, a family lives with just basic sustenance. It wasn't like he stole a cow and they had T-bones for dinner. It was oatmeal. Basic nutrients.
This bench right here very easily could have been exactly where he sat 200 plus years ago,
thinking of his wife when he'd get out. Just amazing.
He does the time, and one thing is clear. Johanna is happy to see him. She has their daughter, Selma, in 1872. From then on, Lars is determined to show the family the love they deserve.
He leases a home near Fredsburg for his family to live in. With a small piece of land, he can farm. But those golden family vibes just don't seem to happen.
One by one, their children move out and move on. I know the feeling when they leave, especially when you've lost someone. I think you cherish the children a little bit more.
Oldest son, Franz August, is first. He takes off and doesn't turn back. He marries and has a son in Gotland. Then he moves his entire family to Michigan in 1880. His sister, Maria, joins him there 1 year later. She and her husband, Carl Åkesson, a fellow Swede from Farnborough in Värmland, had three sons before Maria's untimely death of stomach cancer in 1903. She was just 45 years old. Their oldest son is Gordon Åkesson, an Americanization of Åkesson. Gordon marries Signe Pettersson from heavily Swedish-American St. Paul, Minnesota.
Their son is born in 1917. Irvin Åkesson, your morfar. And that's where it all began for me. Best man I ever knew. I'm glad we came from the stock we did. We're not quitters. Most of us were pretty daggum good husbands. I feel appreciation for this opportunity and respect for my history.
Make you homesick for a home you never had.
And I kind of look at this as if maybe I could lead our family back together and get back to our Swedish roots. I get to share this now with my family, and that might be the biggest reward of all.
I want to know exactly who you are, then hang me in the Tulsa County Stars.
Class. So glad to see you.
Anders School is one of the best parts of our week, and I'm glad that we get to learn about Sweden through his eyes.
This is Sweden's most iconic film star, Greta Garbo, known to have used the same line in several movies, "I want to be alone," thereby said to have spoken for the whole Swedish nation. So it's a good start for today's class about the lonely Swede. Or the myth of the lonely Swede.
I haven't gotten much of an impression of loneliness. I've been seeing lots of examples of community and people coming together and having good friends and like having like lots of get-togethers.
Looking at the way we live in Sweden, it seems to confirm that we are lonely. More than 50% of Swedish households are single households, more than anywhere else in Europe, probably in the world. Our career as loners start early. In Sweden, we move away from our parents when we're 18, 19, on average. It's 26 in Europe.
I think I can actually relate to how the Swedes do it because I also moved away from my family. You know, when I was 18, I went to college and I consider myself a very happy person, you know, but you can still have a strong family values while, you know, doing what you need to do to make yourself happy.
We have twice as many single households as Spain. Twice as many Spaniards feel depressed. So the lonely, depressed Swede is just not to be found in studies, surveys, or statistics. Actually, on the contrary, UN has made a list of the happiest people on the planet, and guess who made it to top 10?
Woo!
Woo-ha! Sweden is here, number 7. Yeah. It's good. You're not even on the list, guys.
Ouch.
So, the idea of the lonely Swede is often that the trust we feel for the society and its institutions made us feel less in need of having tight bonds with family, maybe neighbors. But actually, it seemed to be almost the other way around. Our trust in society made it possible for us to have a bit looser ties with family and maybe look for connections, build a network elsewhere. So it seems like our social life looks different, but we're not lonely. Actually, when looking up on Greta Garbo, she says, "I never said I want to be alone. I want to be left alone." That's all the difference. So today's word is egentid, alone time. Swedes need their
egentid.
Important word. Study it, live it, learn it, become Swedish.
I believe that I have the Swedish genetics for egentid because I am very independent. I love my friends and I love talking on the phone, but I also can just be in my own thoughts for hours and listen to music and do my own thing.
He was born in the summer of his 27th year, coming home to a place he'd never been before.
I grew up in South Dakota. My family were some of the original pioneers there. They moved into the prairie before there were even any trees. So the home that I'm living in now was my father's cabin that he was moving to retire. Lived there for about a year, and then he passed away unexpectedly of pancreatic cancer.
I found it. This is Dad's journal from Sweden.
He wanted me to continue working on the cabin, and he knew how much I just enjoyed the mountains, and we've been like
working on it nonstop through the whole pandemic, my husband and I.
Oh, this says that he visited where Grandpa Pearson lived.
Where was that?
It doesn't say.
Just that he went there?
Yeah. I hope I get to find out.
We'll find out where that is.
Yeah. Oh, how sweet.
He was full of life, and he always told me that the only thing he wanted was for me to be happy.
He always encouraged me at 18 to move out of the house and to follow my dreams, and told me that he believed in me to go be anything I wanted.
And so, even though we're grief-stricken, we're just living a happy life and just trying to fulfill his legacy.
How cool. 50 years later, I should be in Sweden the same time that he was there.
I'm gonna miss you.
I'm gonna miss you so much, and our dogs, and our house, but I know you're gonna take good care of it for me.
I do think that this is a really cool opportunity to keep my father close to me and to fulfill his dream here on Earth to come back to Sweden. It was always something that he wanted to do.
This town ain't changed, still the same. This town ain't changed, and it knows my name.
I have a strange calm about me. This is where I'm supposed to be. I have been waiting my whole life to find out more about my Swedish heritage. I am so happy and excited to open the chest. I'm ready. My father did talk about his Swedish relatives, like how lovely they were and how kind and generous and how they just brought him into their home. And they knew that he had a sense of adventure in him. And so they tried to fulfill that, and he was always forever grateful. Dear Brittany, welcome to Venice Municipality in the wild Swedish north. You are now at a place called Fällforsen. The village here dates back to 1764, when its first homestead was built. But the trapping pits found in Fällforsen show that folks have lived here since long before its lovely settlers' village was built. Sweden's Northlands carry an almost mystical aura in the national literature and arts. So you should be happy that this is your place, your origin.
And this just feels so at home to me, with the beautiful rolling farmlands and the beautiful pine trees and mountains where I live now. So I love it here.
Your three times great-grandparents were Per Hansen and Anna Margareta Per's daughter, both born and raised here in Venice. They were married on November 7th, 1847. Their first child was born just 5 months later, a son named Per Pearson. Per Pearson grew up in farming life and eventually bought his own farm in Orula, Venice, in 1869. He ran a small country store there, selling farmhouse basics. He and his wife, Carolina Eriksdotter, had 15 children, but lost 8 of them to the ravages of life on the frontier.
Their youngest son, Arvid, is one of the surviving children. He is your great-grandfather. He is the Swedish homesteader who will replant your family tree in the foreign yet familiar ground of the American frontier. That just seems so close to home. Like, I remember going to his house. Not very much. I just have one memory. But I remember what the house looked like. That was a special memory. I'm happy to at least have one.
Arvid's most terrible day came just before his 7th birthday, in the summer of 1901. That's the day they found his mother, Carolina, swinging by a rope in the barn.
Her suicide was a dagger in Arvid's young heart. Your relatives say that he would tell that he missed his mama every moment for every day of the rest of his whole life. Her burial was muted and not celebrated by the church, the same as a non-suicide would have been.
This just rings so clear to my heart because I understand about missing someone you love every day.
You know, growing up, you can only hope that you have somebody to be a great role model. And it's just devastating when someone's ripped from your life when you're not ready.
In the aftermath, Per struggled to take care of his kids. Fortunately, his oldest daughter, Anna, stepped up and stepped in. She was already a married adult with a growing family of her own. She took Arvid into her home as one of her own without a question. Arvid grew up there alongside Anna's own 12 children. Technically, Arvid's nieces and nephews, but in practice, more like his siblings. By Arvid's teenage years, adventurous Swedes had begun looking west rather to the untamed north. Arvid immigrated in 1910 at age 16. He and a friend named Edvin left Vanus in April. On May 6th, they boarded the SS Aristo and sailed out of Gothenburg Harbor. It was a long, arduous voyage that took them through Hull, England on the way to America. And that was only half of it. There remained their long trek across the new continent's formidable terrain before finally reaching Salem.
Upon their arrival, the Boers were greeted by an entire host of family already in place. Besides his uncles, their wives, and their 17 children, Arvid's two natural siblings and two of Anna's children, Eric and Oscar Lundgren, were all in Salem to welcome them on the day they arrived. Home to his new home. A most remarkable replant from one frontier to another. I just am so proud of his adventurous spirit. My family's always encouraged us to trailblaze our own paths and follow your heart. I can see that in my relatives here from Sweden. It's an incredible journey that we've made from this very area.
The rest is history. Arvid Persson left several siblings back here on Swedish soil. Closest among them is, of course, Anna. You will find her grave over at the churchyard in Vind Ellen, where she is buried next to her husband, Johan, and their three children. Arvid died unmarried with no children at 80, and two girls, Svea and Marta, who both died at just 11 years old.
This is such a beautiful resting place for my family, and this relative has the fortitude that I can feel in each and every one of my cousins and aunties and uncles, and especially my dad. How powerful.
Arvid Persson became Arvid Pearson across the sea, a man at home with the rhythms of life on the American frontier. So the constancy in your family saga becomes clear. That same adventurous spirit that animates all these generations at once also animates you. In time, the now American Arvid Pearson married Laura Page. Second born of their six sons is Eugene, your far-far.
For them to just say, okay, let's go to a new place to make a better life for our future generations. I just am so, so grateful for that. Because they made such a beautiful life for me.
Today has been the most emotional day of my entire trip. I felt that my father's presence was here with me. My whole goal of coming to Sweden was to connect with the past and bring his spirit back to Sweden and to honor his life, and
brought some of his ash with me from the States, from Colorado, and I just know that this is where he wants to be. You're back where we're from in Sweden. We love you so much.
The This is a sacred place to me, and I'm so happy I got to share that with the world.
Hannah lights up the room immediately. So friendly. I had no idea we'd be getting to spend a whole evening with her and her family, and it's amazing.
Is this where you live?
I know, this is so great.
My gosh, it's beautiful.
When we were walking up, looking around, to me, that's what all of Sweden I thought was going to look like. And I've been waiting to get this one moment where you look around and you're just in a beautiful village surrounded by green pastures and forests and red barns. And then we walked up here and it was even more beautiful. I mean, I was in awe. Unbelievably beautiful.
So are you ready for the grand tour?
Yes.
Yeah, this is the garden.
This is the greenhouse?
Yeah, that's the most recent building in the farm.
Do you need to ever buy vegetables, or is this all the vegetables that you would use?
This is a serious garden.
We haven't bought vegetables in a month or two, I think.
Wow.
They don't buy vegetables at the store. They eat these vegetables, and that was like mind-blowing to me, like that they grow all the vegetables they need right here on the farm, and that's amazing.
We needed a cucumber for dinner, so.
Oh, that's good.
Mm-hmm. It's really good.
That's a nice little snack.
Mm-hmm.
No doubt.
Oh!
So here it says what you're going to pick.
Okay.
Oh, wait. To pick.
To pluck.
Yeah. My Swedish may be getting better, but it's not quite as good as knowing what all the things on the list were. Oh, these are. Look at
what?
Oh my gosh! Can I pull up a beet?
I feel like we're so one with nature, right? Like. We're picking our dinner from a garden in the Swedish countryside.
The lifestyle of this place is, it's much more along the lines of what I imagine my ancestors experiencing. I imagine they had to grow their own food. They had to think about how to supply their food for the entire year.
Yeah.
You know?
I feel like I've heard before that, like, you know, Sweden is lush farmland, and I feel like I'm really getting a sense of, like, oh, look at the bounty we are collecting from the land. Yeah.
How would you describe your life up here in the north?
It's nice and quiet, and it's quite close to Umeå, who is a fairly big city with a university and a hospital and everything. But so you get kind of that part of life where you can have an interesting career and so on. But you also can live on a farm and have a lot of kind of outdoor activities if you want to go skiing in the wintertime or if you want to go hunting and so on. That type of lifestyle is very accessible in this part of Sweden, I would say.
Something my wife and I have been discussing a lot is we've kind of been wanting to get out of the city, but maybe be close to the city so you can get the best of both. But I mean, something about just being out here and having nature all around having the quiet with your family, it's just perfect. It really does.
Yeah.
I can get down with the Nordic lifestyle. This is good. There's part of me that really enjoys the busyness of a city or like being in my recording studio. But then there's a whole other part of me where like just having peace and still and quiet like this and just get away from it all, get disconnected. I think it feels really right.
Yeah, I'm gonna try some moose for the first time. I'm so excited. All right, well, anybody else who's had the moose, I'm excited. This is my first moose adventure. It's so tender.
It's so good.
It's so tender, and it's like beef with way more flavor.
It's sort of a goal to be more
self-sustainable.
Yeah.
I mean, you guys have such an interesting environment here, so The fact that you foraged the mushrooms, you shot the moose, you know, you grew the garden. This is as close to farm to table as you're gonna get. Mm. And the fact that you're sharing it with us is mind blowing and just tuxmicket.
Skål! Skål!
Yeah. Thank
you for coming.
Last week when Michael left, it was hard for all of us. He was such a cool dude and everyone liked him. And it's definitely setting in that we're gonna slowly be kind of chipped away one at a time. And it's gonna come down to one at the end. The competition is more real than it's ever been.
I wanna make it through this competition today because I wanna meet my family, and that's what I'm here for. And I've got to kill this competition in order to make it to that goal.
Hello, welcome. Today's competition is about summer torments, sommarplågor. Every Swedish summer has a soundtrack, a song that gets stuck in your head. You might not remember what summer you bicycled around Gotland, had that lousy summer job, or fell in love with Ingela or Kenta. But you remember what song you sang. And that way we could figure out what year it was. And today, if you want to stay in Allt för Sverige, you too will have to learn this clever and efficient way of separating past Swedish summers. Good luck.
Tack.
Amerikanerna får en halvtimme på sig att lyssna in sig på 30 svenska superhits och ska memorera vilka år dessa var stora. När man fått 5 rätt kan man pusta ut, då har man gått vidare till nästa vecka. Den person som är sist kvar får packa väskan och resa hem igen till USA.
I don't know if this is a good plan or bad plan, but I'm only gonna try to memorize 20 of the songs. Because you figure people are going to miss some, they're going to forget some, and as long as I've got a certain set down, then I'll get to 5 fast.
I am a little more nervous about this competition. I feel like music is not my strong point, and especially foreign music. So to not have an ear for the language, to not be have a musical background, I am just a little overwhelmed. You may action it. Look me for I need to die. I'm a music lover, so I hope that plays in my favor today. I've grown up listening to oldies, and I kind of have a summer theme for every summer of my life, so hopefully this comes as second nature.
Yeah, I'm very focused. You know, this day's been a long day already, and the sooner we can get to it, the sooner I can find out if my memory is still as good as I think it is.
Are you ready? Okay, here's the first song. Summer in the City, Angel. And show me your boards. Correct year is 1992.
So I was a history major in college, and then I also took a class in college called Soca Salsa Reggae, Music of the Caribbean, where all we did was memorize songs and dates. So I'm feeling pretty good about this.
Show me your boards, please. And the year was 2018. Two of you have got 3 rights, Trevor and John. 2 more and you are safe.
You know, I think we're all at the same disadvantage because we don't actually have a summer to tie it to. If we had memories to tie it to, then this game gets really easy.
So
correct answer is 2006. Trevor, one more, and you're safe. If you're Swede, you know what summer this is. It's a legendary summer. It was the summer of 94. Trevor, congratulations. You're safe.
It feels fucking fantastic that I'm safe at least until next week. It's a weight off the shoulders, and I'm gonna try to keep it like that.
John, you need one more, then you're safe. Sally, Erica, Nicole, 3 points. Two more, and you're safe. In the year 2012. Nikki looks happy. Sally seems self-assured.
Maybe too much.
The year was 1988. Oh. Sally, Nikki, congratulations.
I feel so relieved. And then that moment of just like, okay, I can relax for a few days.
I'm a musician. I play in an orchestra, so I've got the music stuff down and I've got the year stuff down. I really love math and numbers. So combined, it's like tailor-made for Nikki.
Gee. That was so stressful.
Sharon, you got one. Brittany, Brett, you're still waiting for your first. Erica, 3 points. Yeah. And John, one more and you're safe.
Keep it going.
Yeah. John, you're safe.
I came in just stressed, and as soon as we put the music on, and I was like, what are you doing? Just have fun. And so, yeah, I feel really good.
Okay, here's the next song. Summer of 2006. Erica, one more and you're safe. Here's the next song. Jag trivs bäst i öppna landskap. Almost like a national anthem. And the year, 1982.
Yes.
So Sharon, you got 2 points. '83, congratulations.
Thanks, Anders. I was very happy when I got my fifth correct answer because I knew it right away because it was the only song that was also a hit during my birth year. So I was very, very happy that my birthday was also my winning number.
You know, every time you go into a challenge day, it puts you on edge because no one wants to go home by losing in a competition.
1998. Sharon, you got 4. Brittany, 2. Brett, still waiting for your first. Here's the next one. Hey, hey, Monica, hey, poor, hey, Monica. Hey, Monica, hey, poor, hey, Monica. Hey, Monica, hey, poor, hey, Monica. Hey, Monica, 2004.
Good job.
As the weeks go on, the intensity just keeps heightening and it just makes you so nervous that it could be your turn.
Here's another hit. Brett, got it.
Finally.
Brittany, you got 2 points. Brett, you got 1. The year was 1987. You both, yeah, you both got it. Here's another summer hit. Brett, you got it. So you both get 3 points. Two more, and you're safe. And you think you look like
like James Bond when you're smoking your cigar. It's so bizarre.
And the year was 1975. So 4-4. One more and you're safe. Håkan Hellström, känner ingen sorg för mig i Göteborg. And we do have a result. Because the correct answer is 2000. Brett.
Job.
Congratulations.
She said Lily in it. That was my daughter's. That's our daughter's name.
Congratulations.
Wasn't my game. It's a bummer. I was hoping to be at least in the final four, so it's a little sooner than I wanted. A lot sooner.
I'm headed back to Colorado. So,
yeah. I am going to miss Brittany unbelievably.
I love you so much.
I love you too.
So much.
She's my girl on this trip, and I don't have her anymore.
I wasn't ready for this.
No.
Love you.
We miss you.
I miss you guys so much.
This journey has spanned years for me to be able to come to Sweden. So the fight, the stress, the highs and lows that came with it, I would say were all worth it. I have so many memories that I'll cherish and share with all the people back home. So.
Yeah. I'll give you some more that you can share with your people back home. This is everything we found out about your Swedish past.
Wow.
Yeah, you got it.
Thank you.
I've learned that I come from a long line of adventurers, fighters, and that they have like a major pioneer spirit. And I've always felt that in myself, and I'm gonna go back really proud about that. I feel fulfilled. I'm ready to go home.
This is beautiful.
Personally, I thought that this would be an adventure of a lifetime, and it proved that. I love Sweden.
How would you feel about going into the wild?
Oh!
Your finger does not go into this hole until you're ready to fire. It lives here all day long.
It's just too much.
We all think there is too much weapon in the States.
This is you're asking a dangerous question.
This is a touchy subject.
Cafe cock.
Oh.
Cafe cock, huh?